Is it a time to be worried? Is it a time to be fretting over the things that look like they're happening? How many of you know there's more smoke and mirrors going on right now than ever before? Oh, yeah. Well, God's not limited by all of that. He's always counting on a people who know Him, who have the Spirit of God on them, and they have the ability to discern and to understand the times and be able to move around all of those kinds of things. And He loves to impart wisdom. You know that promise in James 1, any man lacks wisdom. That means if you lack God's perspective in what's going on in your choices, all you have to do is ask God. And He said He liberally pours out of heaven's understanding and perspective on what's going on. And so we never have to be in a position of being victimized. I want to talk to you this morning a little bit about moving, learning how to move from a place of where we can feel like we're the victim of circumstances and other people and into a place where we deliberately choose to line up with God, who is always victorious, always overcoming, who has spoken precious promises over us, and become the victor with Him. Anybody want that? Okay, I want you to turn to 2 Chronicles 13. I actually brought this message over at Cowboy Church a number of weeks ago. I wasn't planning on speaking on this at all that night, and God just dropped it on me, and I said, I really want you to speak from this text tonight. And it was a lot of fun. I love this story. Stories like this make you fall in love with the Bible, because our God is, He knows the end from the beginning. We're trusting God for what's out in the future, but I tell you, He's already been in our history. God has already done amazing things. And the more you know about what He's already done and how He's worked with people, the more you're going to be able to grab a hold of your present moment and begin to speak into it. So that's something that a victor does. A victor doesn't accept what's going on and just roll over with it. You don't just lay down and say, well, que sera, sera, for all you Doris Day fans. Okay, if you're a millennial, you didn't get that. We don't roll over. If God is in your life, if you are a covenant person, if you know who you are in God's sight, if you know who He is and you know who you are, we talked about that a lot at the conference last weekend. It's so important to know these two things. Who is God to me? And who am I to Him? You answer those questions in any circumstance, and you will completely redefine the whole situation. And then from that place, once you understand the perspective of heaven over you and your circumstances, from that place, you can take your authority and you can begin to speak. You can begin to act. And you can actually watch God step in and start turning some things around. And that's what I love in this story. It's such a clear example. In this story, we see a king named Abijah. He is the grandson of Solomon. And I don't have time to cover this ground, but if you understand the history of the kings of Israel, you start with David, to whom God made a covenant and gave him all these promises and said, you'll never fail to have a son sitting on the throne. And then Solomon comes along, and Solomon takes everything up to another level. Unfortunately, Solomon did not do well toward the end of his reign, and it unleashed a lot of things into Israel that should not be there, but judgment began to come. The enemy was given a door. There was an enemy of Solomon that was operating at that time. The guy's name was Jeroboam. He fled and went off to another country, waiting for an opportunity to do what he wanted to do in Israel. But God spoke to Solomon and said, because of what you've done, I'm going to end up having to, your kingdom is going to be divided. And sure enough, when Solomon's son, Rehoboam, came to the throne, Rehoboam made a lot of dumb mistakes. He was wet behind the ears. Cowboy church would call him Greenhorn. he was not walking in the ways of his father. And anyway, so the end result is that judgment came on Israel, and then it was divided. Now you have two kingdoms within Israel. So there was Judah, which Judah and Benjamin, who remained with Rehoboam and in Jerusalem, there in the center. And then you had this guy Jeroboam, who showed up on the scene, and he stole away the rest of Israel and led them off into idolatry and all kinds of awful things. And he was determined. One of the things that he did is he was afraid that the people of Israel would want to go back to Jerusalem to bring their sacrifices and for the temple worship and observe the feasts and so forth. And he knew that if they went back, they would probably realign themselves with Rehoboam. And so in order to have control over the people's hearts, what he did is he raised up some false gods. And he said, these are now your gods. He built false altars of worship there and sacrifice. And anybody who wanted to be a priest, if you had enough bucks and enough savvy, he'd put you in place. And so he established an entirely false system of worship, like what we have today called political correctness. Substitute. Looks moral. Looks right, satisfies what the need of the heart to feel like you're doing the right thing, but it's completely not based in God at all. And so Jeroboam does something that God severely judges him for and talks about Jeroboam for generations after that. He always refers back to the sins of Jeroboam. And so you have Rehoboam and you have Jeroboam, and Jeroboam's kingdom is still referred to as Israel in the Bible after this. But then with Rehoboam, you have Judah. So Rehoboam did not live very long. He dies, and his son, Abijah, comes to the throne. Now he's the grandson of Solomon. What's Abijah going to do? Well, fortunately, the scripture tells us that Abijah followed after the ways of God. So in chapter 13, we'll just start with verse 1. In the 18th year of King Jeroboam, Abijah became king over Judah. He reigned 3 years in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was blah, blah, blah. Now there was a war between Abijah and Jeroboam. And Abijah began the battle with an army of valiant warriors, 400,000 chosen men, while Jeroboam drew up in battle formation against him with 800,000 chosen men who were valiant warriors. You do the math, you got a problem, right? 2-1. How many of you like to be caught in those circumstances? Now, you got to know this about God. God actually likes those odds. See, we serve a God who says one will put 1,000 to flight, two, 10,000. Now, how do you come up with that kind of math, God? See, it's all about his glory. It's all about his glory on display. And God has chosen that his glory will be on display through his people. If he can find somebody who trusts in him, who cling to him, be faithful to him, walk in his ways, God says, there's no limit to what I can do in the earth through you. But he also has an enemy, the devil, who has been trying to steal the glory of God from the eyes of the people in the earth so they would not know him and worship him. And so God is at war with the enemy. By the way, God is not worried about the devil. The devil is God's devil. He plays him like a yo-yo any way that he wants. But he allows the enemy to come in against us so that he can gain a visible victory and be glorified through it. And so you and I need to learn how to position ourselves with God so that when we're in the circumstances where we're outnumbered 2-1, where the the scripture says when the enemy comes in like a flood, what happens? So God's initial instinct is raise up a standard. But that's for those who are looking for God to be that to them. We have to know, who is God to me? What is he like? How does he see me? Does he care for me? Are the promises with me? All of those kinds of things. It's so important for you and I to know exactly who we are. If you don't know who you are, if you don't know how God sees you, you're not going to have the confidence to stand in the midst of the attack. And Satan is very good at bringing the attack and then accusing you of not being anybody worth saving. That there's something wrong with you, that you're not God's favorite. There's no favor with you. And then we become fearful, we become insecure, and then we try to, and then we panic and we do all kinds of things that are not productive at all. But we walk with the God who so often has said to his people, stand and watch the salvation that I shall bring. For the battle is not yours, it's mine. Now, it's so important for you and I to understand that God has taken ownership of all of our battles, even the battles that we have caused. Circumstances that we created, God is still with us. He's still for us. He may allow us to get a little chastised in our circumstances because of it, but you need to understand God has said, you're mine and I've got you covered. So Abijah finds himself in a battle that he did not choose. He's a peaceful man. He's only been on the throne for 3 years. And Jeroboam sees an opportunity. It's kind of like what Putin is doing right now with our president, our administration. Any perceived weakness, the enemy wants to move in and test us and see if he can knock us down. Now, here's something you need to know about God. God actually will allow the enemy to come and attack because he wants us to find our strength in him. He also wants us to know where we are vulnerable, where the wall has been broken down, where we might have an Achilles heel. And it's important to know those things, right? In fact, part of your holiness is to have made yourself so complete in God that there isn't any place where the enemy can come at you and take you down. It's not that the issue is no longer about, is the enemy attacking you? It's about whether he can succeed in his attack. We were made for war. I like what Mike was speaking over his kids. You're covered with armor. All right. So Abijah is in this situation. 2-1. If you're Abijah, how are you feeling right now? I mean, you put yourself in his sandals. Jeroboam has come into his territory. They are probably lined up in battle array. And as was very typical in those days, is that usually there was a valley that was going to be the place of battle. And you'd have an army on one side of the valley, on those hills, gathered in camp there. And then you'd have the opposing army on the other side. And they all knew, it's all going to get duked out right down here in the middle of this valley. And so in this situation, we have Judah, with King Abijah on one side, got Rehoboam over on the other side. They could see each other. And if you're looking at twice as many people on the other side than what you have, you might be having a few thoughts that are not positive. But this is why it's so important for the people of God to stand up in this day and take the lead. There's never been more fear and confusion in our nation than there is right now. We got people all around us, your neighbors, your family members, your coworkers. They're afraid. They're worried about a lot of things. They don't know which end is up. So it's time for the people of God, the people who know their God, to rise up and do valiantly. It's time for us to take the lead. You don't have to have political control. You don't have to be at the top of the corporate ladder or whatever in order to lead. You just have to know God and have a voice and not be afraid and to be able to declare an outcome. And this is what Abijah does. I love this. It says, then Abijah stood on Mount Zamarim, which is in the hill country of Ephraim, and he said, now I want you to picture this. He's standing up on this mountain, and he is yelling across this valley to the opposing army. Now, I don't know what kind of lungs he had on him, but he didn't have a sound system. He didn't have a megaphone. But he is speaking loud enough so as to be heard by the other army on the other side. Now, if you're up on a high place and you're yelling across the valley, your sound wave, the sound waves of your voice are going to carry. And so Abijah is intentionally speaking to Jeroboam on the other side in his camp to communicate very clearly something to them. And I love what he's saying. You and I need to get a clue from this. He says, listen to me, Jeroboam, and all Israel. I'm talking loud because he was talking loud. I mean, he's literally yelling this out. Now, what's so cool is his army's hearing this too. He's leading. By the way, we very often don't know who is within the range of the sound of our voice when we're speaking the truth. But it's important that we're speaking. It's important that we're declaring things. And so he's yelling out, listen to me, Jeroboam and all Israel. Do you not know that the Lord God of Israel gave the rule over Israel forever to David and his sons by a covenant of salt? What's Abijah doing? He's reminding Jeroboam and his army who's with God. He's calling to their remembrance, who are we? Important for you and I to know who we are by covenant. I stand in a covenant relationship with God. I stand in something that's been set in the heavenlies already in past history, and I'm right now in the middle of this. Abijah was not there when the covenant was made with David, but Abijah knows who he is in relationship to that covenant. There was a covenant that we're going to celebrate here in just a little bit, settled on the cross. And you and I are still standing in it now. We stand in a covenant with God. Some things have already been settled. Our identity with God and his promises toward us has already been settled. You can't earn it. You can't make it happen. Abijah couldn't earn it either. He just was there. He knows who he is. He knows what's already been given to him. I have to remind myself of that over and over and over again. Because the enemy always likes to come after our identity. And so Abijah is saying, I'll tell you who I am. And sometimes in the warfare that the enemy brings to you, the first thing you need to do is say, I know who God is, and I know who I am to him. You got to settle that first before you fight. And this is what Abijah is doing. He's saying, I'll tell you who I am. Let me tell you who you're coming against. I'm the great-grandson of David. And I stand in covenant lineage with him. And all these people that are with me, this entire army, we are covenant people. It was already settled in heaven a long time ago. This is who you're coming against. Now, it's important to be able to tell the enemy what he's doing. Basically, Abijah's telling Jeroboam, you're about to do something really stupid because you're not coming against me. You're actually coming against God who made this covenant with me. Do you believe that about you? When the enemy's coming after you, is he just messing with you or is he messing with God? Well, go back and ask the question, who is he to me? Who am I to him? Do you not know that the Lord God of Israel gave the rule over Israel forever to David and his sons by a covenant of salt? Yet Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, the servant of Solomon, the son of David, rose up and rebelled against his master. And worthless men gathered about him, scoundrels who proved too strong for Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, when he was young and timid and could not hold his own against them. Scoundrels. Do we have any of those around today? People who have moved into high places and are trying to steal what God has set in order. He said, so now you intend to resist the kingdom of the Lord through the sons of David, being a great multitude and having with you the golden calves which Jeroboam made for gods for you. You intend to resist the kingdom of God with your great multitude. You think that you have more strength, and Jeroboam, you've convinced your people that these false gods are going to cause you to prevail over us. But you've forgotten that you're coming against the God of all gods and against all of his promises. We are his people. So you intend to try and mess with God here. But now, listen to what he says to him. He says, have you not driven out the priests of the Lord, the sons of Aaron and the Levites, and made for yourselves priests like the people of other lands? Whoever comes to consecrate himself with a young bull and seven rams, even he may become a priest of what are no gods. But as for us, the Lord is our God, and we have not forsaken him. And the sons of Aaron are ministering to the Lord as priests, and the Levites attend to their work. Every morning and evening they burn to the Lord burnt offerings and fragrant incense, and the showbread is set on the clean table, and the golden lampstand with its lamps is ready to light every evening. And we keep the charge of the Lord our God, but you have forsaken him. Now, let me drill something into here. Abijah is saying, we have been faithful to God. We're doing everything God has told us to do. We have kept his commandments. We have ordered our lives and everything else. We have continued to be faithful to all of those things. And because of that, we are operating within his covenant, and we have confidence to stand before you here today. And he's saying to them, but you are out of order. And you have no reason to believe that you have any ability to take us out. He's actually appealing to them and reminding them of who they used to be and what they used to do and where they came from. But he's also reminding his own people why they can have confidence to stand before their enemies. When you, as a believer, as a follower of Jesus, when you know that you are doing the will of God. I'm not talking about you know you're perfect, but I'm talking about you know you have been faithful. You know that you're doing the best you know how to try and follow the Lord. You've been obedient to God. God is in the center of your camp. His word is supreme to you. You've given your heart over to him. And you know you've been making consistent choices. Sometimes it's 3 steps forward, 2 steps back, but you haven't changed course. You're consistently pressing in to say, I'm going to be the people of God. I am going to live according to the life that he has given me. I'm working out my salvation with fear and trembling, because it's God who's at work in me, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. When you know that you have been faithful with the Lord, you also have the confidence to be able to stand before your enemies and say, God's with me, because I've been with him. And it's not because I've been perfect. It's because I know this covenant, and I've been moving with this. I've been living within the love that God has for me. And what he shows me, I do. And what's in his word, I keep. If you've not been faithfully walking with God, you will not have confidence in the day of conflict. It's just the way it is. I'm not saying you still can't cry out to the Lord and have the Lord come and deliver you. But it's the confidence factor. See, I love what Abijah's doing. He's saying, hey, we're the people of God, and we have not departed from that. We're doing everything that we know God has asked us to do. Therefore, we know God is pleased with us. We know we're acting as a covenant people. God is in our midst. We're not taking anything for granted. We haven't moved off center with God. We're taking things to the next level. It's so important in the days that we're heading into right now for you and I to really be looking at all of our choices and just saying, how consistent am I? How faithful am I with the things of God in my life? Am I compromising? Am I saying, well, that's, you know, there's nothing so wrong with that, whatever, you know, and we're just kind of playing around the edges a little bit, see how much we can get away with, and, you know, that kind of attitude. Or are we just, you know, hey, I'm in love with God. He's in love with me. And his word and his ways are so valuable to me. There's life there. So I'm walking with him. You know what that does is that when the enemy comes knocking to accuse you, you can push back. You can say, I know who I am to God, and I know how I've been living. So Abijah is able to stand confidently before his enemy and just say, you're the one that's out of order. I have been faithful to God. And I have every reason to expect that God is also going to be faithful to us. I hope you got that. There's too many people that are going to be trying to lean into, when they're having battles, they're going to be trying to lean into, well, you know, God just loves me all the time anyway, and his grace is just so extensive, and it's all just somehow going to work out. But deep in their heart, they know they have not been faithful to God. The grace is very important. Thank God for all this amazing grace. We wouldn't be where we are right now if it wasn't for that. Your ability to even be faithful to God, to even have a thought or a desire to do so, is because of His grace. But see, Paul said in Philippians 2, he said, you know what? God is working in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. That's part of what happened to you when you received salvation. You received the Spirit of God, and He's in you for a result of something that He's looking for. And he said, so therefore, you and I need to be working out our salvation with fear and trembling. Don't take it for granted. Because there's a quality of life that comes on you, and there's a confidence that comes to you, especially when you're standing up against your enemies. See, part of the armor of God, somebody asked me on my way in, they were playing with me, and they said, hey, you got your helmet of salvation on? I had to stop for a moment. Well, I got my belt of truth on. Now, what are we walking in? That's a good question to ask yourself. What am I walking in today? I'm loving Him. And His ways are important to me. His word is important to me. We don't get legalistic about it. We don't become judgmental about it. But, you know, there's just the difference between someone who has said, I know the ways of God. I know what He's asked us to do. I love what one of the kids here said at their baptism, when I said, why are you getting baptized? I'm obeying God. This is what you do when you're following Jesus. You get baptized. Classic answer. And so, he's after being baptized, he can now say, I just obeyed the Lord. There's something that comes into a person's life when you realize, I have obeyed the Lord. I have done what He has said. I've reordered my life after Him and His ways and His desires. There's something that comes into your heart and your spirit where you now have a confidence to be able to stand against your enemy. I love what Jesus said just before He was going to be crucified. He said to His disciples, He said, the enemy's coming after me, but he has nothing on me. Wouldn't you love to be able to say that? The enemy's coming, but he's not going to be able to take me down because there's nothing for him to grab a hold of. It's important. If it was important for Jesus, it's certainly important for us. And this is what Abijah is saying in the presence of his men. And I think it gave them great confidence because these soldiers needed to know, yeah, that's right. We are God's people. Yeah, that's right. We've been keeping the word of the Lord. Yeah, we have been faithful to God. And when you remind yourself of who you are, how God sees you, and that you have been walking in His ways, the Spirit of the Lord can come easily upon you with a confidence to expect that more of God is about to happen in your life. Whoa. I don't have more time to deal with that one. It says, so he makes this declaration. Now behold, God is with us at our head. Those are powerful words. Is he just making up those words? Or is it true to him? That's what you and I need to be able to say. Behold. That means open your eyes and get a good look. See something you may not have seen before. See, I want to be able to tell other people, behold, God is with me. He is at the head of everything in my life. I was dealing with something yesterday and began to pray into it, and that verse came up inside of me. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him. And I just stepped right into that place of the angel of the Lord is around me, and I went, nah, 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 nah. See, I love being able to declare God on my life, his protection on my life, his provision on my life, his faithfulness to me, the victory that's already mine. I don't have to know how he's going to do it. It's not my job. My job is to stay tucked into him and to know who is at the head of my life. And Abijah is declaring to Jeroboam, when you come toward us, guess who you're going to meet first? God is at our head, and his priests with the signal trumpets to sound the alarm against you. O sons of Israel, do not fight against the Lord God of your fathers, for you will not succeed. That was so nice for Abijah to give them a warning. Let them know. He's really telling them, hey, you know, you guys are our brothers. This doesn't need to happen. You're totally deceived. So don't do this, because you're going to lose. Yeah, powerful words. The reason why I'm laboring so much with this with you this morning is because we've got to learn how to talk like this. These aren't just words that sound powerful. They are powerful because they're connected to truth. They're connected to heavenly reality. And either you're walking in that reality or you're not. Abijah is. Abijah is already, see, before Jeroboam ever showed up, Abijah was already cultivating his relationship with God and who he was as a covenant man with his people. He was faithfully keeping the word of the Lord. He knew what was going on over in Israel. He said, we're not going to be like that. We're going to be the people of God. So now Abijah is speaking. Now he's declaring. He's yelling it at the top of his lungs across the valley, and everybody's hearing the truth. What is Abijah also doing? He's also prophesying. He's prophesying the outcome in advance. God is with us. We have the covenant. This is what he said he's going to do. Because God is with us, here's what's going to happen. If you come against us, you will certainly be defeated. Period. It's very important for you and I to have this confidence before God so that when we're in the middle of the circumstance, that we can actually say in advance, this is what's going to happen. For a lot of people, they think that that's arrogance and pride. Some people say that's presumption, or how can you know that? All I can tell you is that you know that you know that you know certain things when you've been walking with God and when you have been digesting and meditating on his word. And you read stories like this, and you say, wow, who is he to me? Who am I to him? What do I know? There have been many times in my circumstance where I've been very confused and fearful, and the Spirit of God will just stop me and say, Paul, what do you know right now? They just say, set all that other stuff aside. All of you are trying to figure out how you're going to work this out and what might happen to you that's going to be painful or whatever. And he'll just say, Paul, what do you know right now? What do you know? And I'll have to dig into my heart and say, well, this is what I know about God. This is what I know about what he said about me. This is what I know that he's promised. And then God will say, do you need to know anything more than that? No. It's enough. And then the Lord would say, okay, from this place of what you know, now speak. Begin to declare. And I'll begin to declare, and sometimes I feel a little shaky. But the more I declare, if you're driving by my house some days, you would think a battle was going on inside my house. You'd be looking for Margie's car to see if I was beating up on her or something. Yeah. Because it gets pretty loud in my house. I don't do this when she's around. But there are times when I'm in the thick of an intense battle. And the Lord will say, begin to declare. Begin to speak. And the fire of God will come. The confidence of God will come. And it's, you know, and the Spirit of the Lord, who is a warrior, and the angels of the Lord that gather around what you're saying, starts to fire this thing up, and I start yelling sometimes. I start being like Abijah, screaming across the valley and saying, this is who I am. This is who God is. Here's the outcome. And I begin to just punch it through, scream it out into the heavenlies to all of my enemies. But you know what? I'm also talking to myself. Because sometimes your mouth by the Spirit has to say what your heart does not yet believe. But the good thing about the Word of God is it comes out of your mouth, it also goes back into your ears. And faith comes by hearing. I don't know if you got that one. You don't have to fully believe what you're saying. It's more important that you're actually saying it until you do believe it. And you're establishing something in the Spirit as you take your stand and you declare the outcome in advance. Try it sometime. You'll feel weird. You'll feel eccentric. First time I ever did that, I was extremely uncomfortable. Because a lot of times we're uncomfortable with our emotions. We're uncomfortable with intensity. If you had been around Jesus, he was one of the most intense people you could meet. Because there was a lot at stake. You need to be so full of faith and so aggressive in the Spirit that you scare yourself. I'm giving you permission to get wild. To do some wild things. See, the battle belongs to the ones who take the arrows and strike it on the ground over and over and over again, even when it feels illogical. But God is with me. Wham, 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 wham. And you don't stop. Now, very quickly, it says that Jeroboam had set an ambush to come from the rear. Obviously, Jeroboam didn't hear a word that he said. Abijah said to him, he set an ambush to come from the rear so that Israel was in front of Judah and the ambush was behind them. And when Judah turned around, behold, they were attacked both front and rear. They set a trap, didn't they? I'll tell you, the enemy loves to set a trap. God's not worried about the enemy's traps. The enemy's always confident because God has made Satan stupid. He overplays his hand a lot. Now, understand, when Satan overplays his hand, he comes on very strong, but he actually sets himself up to be defeated if you know who you are at the moment. Satan never counts on somebody being fully in their identity and full of faith. He's always planning on him being able to take you out. He's planning on you being weak. He's planning on you being just like everybody else. But he finds out very quickly you're not. So when Jeroboam set his trap and he's coming around them from front and back, here's what he wasn't planning on. So they cried to the Lord, and the priests blew the trumpets. What are they doing? They're acting in faith. Their cry to the Lord wasn't, "Oh God, help us! Oh God, we didn't see this coming! Oh no! Lord, can you do this one?" They cried to the Lord and blew the trumpets, which means they knew that the very sound of these trumpets, which were sacred, dedicated trumpets, trumpets of warfare, trumpets of worship, they knew that the sounding of the trumpet was going to release something in the heavenlies that was going to activate the hand of God. They didn't know exactly how it was going to happen, but they knew that all we need in this situation is God. And so they cried unto the Lord. I have a feeling that these soldiers were echoing the very things that Abijah had just spoken. They lift up their voices into the heavens and they cry unto God, the God of their covenant. And they blow the trumpets with confidence of this. See, it's a sense of we are the people of God. We are in alignment with him. He is with us. And when we sound the trumpet, when we lift up our worship, when we declare the war cry, we are only echoing the very voice of heaven over us right now because the shout of the king is in their midst. That's in the scripture, by the way. We start shouting what the king is shouting. We start playing his favorite tune with confidence. It's so important. Be ready with your cry. Be ready with your shout. Be ready with your trumpet. Then the men of Judah raised a war cry. Have you found your war cry, by the way? Every person that knows God has been given a war cry. If you've chosen to just be passive and just kind of ride this thing out and hide in some little place that you can find until Jesus comes back, you are no earthly good to God. And you'll have nothing to show for your life here on the earth when you show up in heaven. You are made for warfare. That means that you have been given a war cry. Every one of us needs to find our war cry. Because when you lift up your war cry, you're actually echoing the voice of God in the earth. It's part of releasing his kingdom here in the earth and seeing things get turned around. If you don't understand what I'm talking about, I'll just trust the Lord's going to show you more of that if you'll not just turn that off. Passive Christianity will kill you. And the enemy's going to steal your lunch eventually. There's a big target on your chest. The day you said yes to Jesus, you became a defector. And the enemy absolutely hates who you are. And there's a big target on your chest. So you might as well figure out, I got to get the armor on. I got to pick up the weapons of my warfare. And I have got to learn how to sound the battle cry, the war cry. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom suffers what? Violence. But Jesus said, and the violent take it by force. Does that sound passive to you? Some of you need to stand in front of the mirror and practice baring your teeth and get your grrr on and your shout on. Some of you need to go buy a sword. I'm serious. Go buy a sword. Pick it up. Then wait until nobody's around, nobody's looking. I'm dead serious about this. I'm telling you, you learn how to pick up a sword and go into the spirit. Just say, no, I'm a person of God right now. I've been called to be a warrior. And you let the Spirit of God come upon you. And you understand that you have a call on your life and you've been given power and authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and defeat all the power of the enemy. And as you hold that sword, you're going to find your grip getting tight. And you're going to find yourself wanting to just kind of lift that thing up and go ahead and lift it. Lift it high. Whew. I wish I could tell you some stories right now. I don't have time. You lift that sword high. And then you let out your battle cry. We've got to find the voice that comes deep from down here. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because he's anointed me to deliver, to set free, to break chains, to flip things upside down, to rescue those in darkness, to declare the favorable year of the Lord. That is all warfare. Something come alive in you that hasn't ever been alive yet until now. So that's the way I have to walk. I have to get into that when I'm walking into a hospital, when I know I'm going into ICU. I'm going to go duke it out with the enemy. So in my car before I go into the hospital, it gets noisy. So they lifted up the war cry. And when the men of Judah raised the war cry, look at this. When, that means there was timing in this. God was looking for, God already knew what he was going to do because of his covenant. But he was waiting for his covenant sons and daughters to operate according to the covenant. So when they lifted up the war cry, they were lifting up a cry that says, God is at our head. And greater is he that is with me and in me than he that is in the world. It says, when they raised the war cry, then it was, when then? And you need to understand, God has created you for the when and then. The circumstances you find yourself in, doesn't matter what they are. You're given an opportunity for a when. Or you're given an opportunity for you to happen, for you to suddenly rise up as a covenant person connected to God. And you do what covenant calls for. When you begin to do something that reveals your faith and your confidence in God that he is with you. When, then there comes a then. The then of heaven that shows up and begins to do something. And you don't always know. Most of the time you don't know what God's going to do. But you need to know you're unleashing something that's going to allow heaven to begin to move. And then it was that God routed Jeroboam and all Israel before Abijah and Judah. We don't know what that looked like. What does it mean that he routed them? Well, it means he got in there and he played ball. Sometimes I imagine there were a few angels, or more than a few, that just got in there and kind of put their foot out. Jeroboam's army is running toward the enemy, and the angels just start tripping them all up. It's kind of like when Reepa Cheeps was hidden and taken out. You had to see the movie. Okay. Prince Caspian, or whatever it was. But it says God routed them. That means the power of God showed up and did what only God could do, that no man could do. They were now dealing with a force, an unseen force, that they could not compete with. And I imagine a great confusion came into the camp, and fear came, and the end result is they became frightened and weak in their own eyes, and they began to run. Wow. And when the sons of Israel fled before Judah, God gave them into their hand. Abijah and his people defeated them with a great slaughter, so that 500,000 chosen men of Israel fell slain. Pretty good odds. You've got 400,000, you take out five. Whew. God give us those kinds of victories in the days ahead. He certainly wants to. Thus the sons of Israel were subdued at that time, and the sons of Judah conquered because they trusted in the Lord, the God of their fathers. That was written, that last line was written there for a reason. They conquered because. That tells me I'm going to conquer for the same reason. Because I trust in the Lord and I've served the God of my fathers. These are one of those verses where I say, get a clue, pay attention. They're for a reason. This is heavenly reality. If you tap into this, you're tapping into something that is more real than anything else going on the planet and is more powerful than what's going on in the White House or anywhere else in the world, where powerful people think that they can control the world. I want to tell you, George Soros is going to meet God, and all the money he has is going to be dirt in his own eyes the day he sees God. I'm hoping that's before he dies. I probably shouldn't have gone there, but so Abijah pursued Jeroboam and captured from him several cities, Bethel and its villages, Jeshana with its villages, and Ephron with its villages. And Jeroboam did not again recover strength in the days of Abijah, and the Lord struck him, and he died. But Abijah, this is what God does to his enemy. But what happens to his own people? Abijah became strong, more powerful. That's always God's plan. You and I watch the enemy defeat our enemies, and we become stronger. We become more powerful. It's always God's plan. God is looking for a very powerful people in the earth. Woo! You might as well become powerful, right? We got a very powerful God, and it's because of his covenant with us. I want to wrap this up with us taking communion together, because God has set a covenant over us. And so if I can get some help bringing the table here, and we're going to have to do a little fancy thing around the baptism tank here. As I look at this table and I see something that's been set in place, as Jesus said, as he took the cup and he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he declared a new thing. I look at these now 2,000 years later and I say, man, have we been set up. This represents not just something that happened historically at the cross. This does not just represent the suffering of Jesus the God-man, the Son, who loved us. It also represents something that is so powerful operating in the earth right now that you and I are connected to it. And so Jesus said, as often as you do this, connect, reconnect with who I am and what I've done. Remember who you are to God. Remember how you've been set up. Remember who He is to you. And come back into that place again and be empowered and strengthened. Are you ready? Let's do this. We're going to go ahead and stand. We're going to make our way this way around the table. Come along each side, and as you take the elements and head back to your seat, and we'll partake together. And let's worship as we do this. As we hold this bread, just ask the question right now. Who are you to Him? Who is He to you? Are you working towards settling that in your own heart? He who did not spare His own Son, but freely gave Him up for us all, how will He not also freely give us all things? Can you just say right now before the Lord, this is who I am to you? Just tell Him, this is who I am. I'll just fill in the blank. Who are you? You know, say it. Anybody say, I'm His beloved. I'm chosen of the Lord. He knew me before the foundations of the world. He chose me and He predestined me to know Him and belong to Him. And He paid the ultimate price to have me. How valuable are you? Thank you, Lord. Lord, I am your son. I'm your daughter. And with me, you are well pleased. And I stand holy in your presence. Let's partake together and thank Him for that. As we take this cup, I'm thinking about what Abijah said to his enemy. He said, We're covenant people. The covenant's already been set in place over my life. And what's going to happen next is going to be according to that covenant, not according to anything that my enemy's going to do. As we hold this cup, I just want us to right now to enter into a confidence before the Lord that He is with us. Not because of anything that we've done, but because the price has already been paid for us and we've been bought now. We're His precious possession. And He has now set His promises over us, and He has committed Himself to be our God, to be our warrior king. And to lead us into victory. Could you say, I am his covenant child, and he is at the head of my life at all that concerns me. And when the enemy comes after me, he's going to run right smack into God, because he loves me and he fights for me. I declare victory over my life. The best is yet to come. Let's partake. I just believe it'd be appropriate for us to lift up a war cry right now, a victory over your life and your future. Are you ready on the count of three? One, two, three. Yes! Yes. Now that's the next thing is, we're heading into some elections, right? There's some things that belong to God in this nation. Don't look at the polls. Look at your God. You know, and it's great for us to be prepared for whatever the outcome is and know that God is with us and he's going to take care of us and all the rest. But I tell you, the election hasn't happened yet. And I just believe that God wants us, if my people. And so can we just take a moment, right? And can we just pray with fervency into this election right now? And let's begin to declare, like Abijah did, the outcome. Just begin to declare it. Prophesy. Prophesy righteousness. Your kingdom come, Lord. Lord, your desire is for your righteousness and your justice to rule and reign in this nation. And so, Father, we pray, we push back the darkness now in the name of Jesus. We push back lies. We push back the darts of the enemy. We push back the cloud of confusion that has deceived the hearts of people. We come against everything that is trying to steal the covenant promises that are over this nation right now. And we say, Lord, do it. Do it. Accomplish it, O God, according to your plan and your will. We just say, we shall be a nation according to the original plan. Lord, we're not going to let go of the plan. We're not letting go of what you put in the hearts of our founders. We just say, Lord, we just fight and we take this back right now in the name of Jesus. We know what belongs to us. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Lord, we say it's time. It's time. We declare a breakthrough right now in the name of Jesus. We declare a breakthrough right now in the name of Jesus over this whole thing, Father. We say, Lord, your kingdom come. Your kingdom come. Your will prevail over your enemies, over all darkness, in the name of Jesus. Lord, prevail, prevail, prevail. We're lifting up the war cry. Go! Go! Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Ready? Here we go. Lord, you know the promises that are over this nation. You know the covenant agreements that were made as this nation was established and as government was set in place, that there was an intentionality, Lord. There was faith that was in operation at that moment when our founding fathers, they knew that this experiment of a nation under God, they knew it could only work if you were at the head and if your people were obeying you and following you and pursued righteousness and justice, which are the foundations of your throne. And Lord, we just say, we're not letting go. We're not surrendering that to whoever thinks that they can come in and establish false gods and false altars and false priests. Lord, we're not letting go of that. We know, Lord, what we could be. And so we're standing in the gap right now. We say now, Lord, do it. What only you can do. What only you can do. Lord, we don't have our eyes on any candidates. We don't have our eyes on, there's no champion except you, Lord. Men and women come and go. Leaders come and go. But you at our head, Lord, that's what we're crying out for. So, Father, we declare a routing of the enemy. We're declaring that you're going to do something these next 2 days that is just going to scatter the enemy. It's going to cause confusion. And that every plan of darkness, every lie, every deception, every intention to manipulate and control an outcome, which is unrighteous and unethical, and you are against it, Lord. We just declare that all of those things are going to be routed. They're all going to be brought down. They're going to be exposed. And Lord, I'm just asking you that you just pull back the veil and just cause every person that's been involved with planned destruction of our enemy, or of our nation, would be fully exposed, Lord. Lord, we're asking you for a clean sweep to come through, and that we would hunger again for righteousness, and we would look to you again, Lord, as our God, that we would repent and say, how did we get here? How did we become like this? And that we would be ashamed and fall on our knees before you and say, oh God, would you come and be our covenant God again? One nation under God. Lord, I declare a day when we're going to stand and proudly say, one nation under Jehovah God. And that we're going to be proud to have on our coins, in God we trust. And that we're going to proudly proclaim to the whole world, all other nations, we are a Christian nation. Jesus is our Savior. And that our best days are yet ahead of us, Lord. Now, Father, release your warring angels across the land. Yes, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, keep praying. Keep declaring in these next couple of days as we're heading into this election. And again, we've got some voting guides out there. We're not trying to take sides here or anything like that or tell anybody how they should vote. We're just sharing information that we have about some of the candidates that are running for justices and other kinds of things, and things that anybody could find out on their own, but this will just save you some of the trouble. And of course, you're going to have to trust us with that information, and we're not being biased here, but we're looking for righteousness again in the nation, and so that's available out on the counter out there as well. And I hope that you pick up stuff for the Christmas child and go get your kids right now. Yes, but hang out at the coffee bar. Let's have a good time, and see you this week, hopefully Wednesday night at our Connect groups.